Wait, you have a TV?
No, I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hey everybody, Ken Reed here. It's Wednesday, it's time for a brand new edition of TV Guidance, Counselor of the Podcast, in which I, your humble host Ken Reed, welcomes a guest to the show. We look at an old issue of TV Guide magazine, and we talk about what we would have watched back that week in history. My guest today is a writer and artist, a graphic novelist, the one and only Mr. Box Brown. You may or may not be familiar with his work. If you are not, I highly recommend it. He has, I believe, 3 books out, the newest of which is called Is This Guy For Real? It is a graphic novel biography of Andy Kaufman, the great Andy Kaufman, specifically focusing on his wrestling years. And Box also did his last graphic novel, which was about Andre the Giant, called The Life and Legend. There's also a great HBO documentary about Andre the Giant out a month or two ago. Unrelated. Although I guess they are technically related because they're both about Andre the Giant. But and he also had a great graphic novel out about Tetris called The Games We Play. Highly recommend all those. They're always on sale at Amazon, and you can get all 3 for like less than $40. And it is a well spent money. He's a great guy. He was up here in Boston from Philadelphia doing some press for the new Andy Kaufman book and was nice enough to take some time out of his busy schedule to sit down and talk to me, probably for longer than we agreed to, and I hope he did not get in trouble with his wife and sister-in-law, who he was supposed to meet after talking to me. So hopefully he's not in trouble there. But anyway, buy his book. You will definitely want to buy it after you listen to me chatting to him. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Box Brown.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Box Brown, how are you?
Good. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. Thank you for, we're in a basement of a Panera Bread.
The best.
Like, I feel like I have to whisper, but I guess we don't really.
It's not a library.
No, it really isn't. Although that would be weird if all libraries were Panera Breads in the future.
It's like Barnes & Nobles have started this whole, like, read a book and drink coffee.
I guess they're like, people are going to be here and not buy anything anyway.
Yeah.
Just read stuff, so we might as well sell them something. Yeah. So it might as well be coffee.
Yeah.
So you're in the midst of your tour for your new Andy Kaufman book. Why did you pick Andy Kaufman?
I wanted to do just like the life of a comedian. I was like thinking about different comedians to focus on, and I was like, I don't know, you know, it's like Richard Pryor. Then for a minute I was like, Roseanne was like awesome, but now like Roseanne, like,
oh, she's insane.
I couldn't do it now. Like, yeah.
Have you ever read any of her autobiographies? Plural?
No, I didn't get that far into it. I was like, yeah, maybe I'll start thinking about what Roseanne's career was like, what her life was like. But then I started following her on Twitter or something. And I was
like, that's a mistake.
I was like, no.
Her book, she talks about, she has like multiple personalities. But it's just like, what are you talking? Like, you're just crazy. Like, you're insane. Yeah. Like, someone needs to help you.
It's messed up. I mean, so I was thinking about that. And when I was promoting my Andre the Giant book, I was invited. Well, what happened was I was at a wrestling show, Ring of Honor wrestling show in Philly, and I saw this guy, like, the crowd at a Ring of Honor show in Philly is mostly like, you know, teens to 30-year-old guys all like screaming and yelling in t-shirts and stuff, and I see this guy, one guy in the crowd is like, you know, gray hair and wearing like a jacket and a suit and a tie and stuff.
Out of place.
Yeah. So I look over and I'm like, oh my God, that's Bill Apter. And he's like, Bill Apter was the editor in chief for Pro Wrestling Illustrated for like a million years.
PWI.
And he was, you know, and like, I guess he was even on WCW TV for a minute and like, you know, he's just a known guy. All those magazines are called Apter magazines. I was like, oh my God, that's Bill Apter.
Yeah.
So I like went over and talked to him for a few minutes. I was like, I did this Andre the Giant book, whatever. He's like, oh, you did the Andre the Giant book. he's like, I want you to come be on my show or whatever. And I was like, really? I was like, yeah. So I exchanged cards with him, whatever, and ended up, I went to Bill Apter's house, and I'm at Bill Apter's house watching, looking at his, you know, all his memorabilia, and I was on his show. And then I was, then I guess, you know, me and my editors were talking about different names popping up, and Andy Kaufman comes up. I'm like, oh yeah, Andy Kaufman. I'm like, Bill Apter actually was the guy that introduced Andy Kaufman to Jerry the King Lawler.
Yeah.
You know, so I was like, oh man, that's, I'm like, yeah, I could probably, then I was like, I always thought that about Andy, about like how his characters and stuff were really influenced by wrestling.
The
I
mean, face
it's like all
the,
wrestling. Yeah. And also that like his, he was before his time as far as like comedian, celebrity involved in pro wrestling.
Yeah.
Like, cause you know, in the early 80s and all before this, you know, the thinking was you didn't want to have a comedian or any celebrity in the pro wrestling ring because it would cheapen what they do in wrestling, make it look less real, basically.
Which is funny, not cheapen the career of the person.
No.
Cheapen the wrestling.
The wrestling, yeah. So they would, WWE turned, it was WWF at the time, or WWWF, and they turned him down. And then, you know, he did this thing with Jerry the King Lawler, and it was like this huge thing. It was on Letterman.
Right.
That slap on Letterman.
It's a real slap?
Yeah. It, like, made the world really believe in wrestling more. Like,
yeah.
It helped. It was,
it gave
like,
it a credibility.
Yeah, it had the opposite effect. And then after that, it was like a million. Couldn't get enough celebrities in wrestling. Yeah. Like, right after that, 85 is, like, rockin' wrestling.
Cyndi Lauper,
yeah. Mr. T, all these like TV stars.
Refrigerator Perry did a Rumble?
Like a Battle Royal, yeah. WrestleMania 2.
I posted something on Twitter the other day as a joke where I was like, G.I. Joe character Refrigerator Perry proved so popular that they actually hired an actor to play him who played in the NFL.
Really?
Which is clearly not true.
Yeah.
And people were like, no, he's a real guy. They made the character be him. Yeah, and I was like, yeah, I know. Yeah, I'm aware of that.
Yeah. So, you know, so if Andy didn't die in 84, I would imagine that he would have been at WrestleMania 1.
Right.
He may have had like a continuing, you know, he could have had like the thinking in wrestling all the time is like, you know, he had a successful run in Memphis.
Right.
You know, he was. You know, they were like there a lot. They sold a lot of tickets. Eventually, they had to change it up because when you run a show every week in the same venue, like you have to keep bringing in new people because you have the same audience. You can't do the same
thing. People flipping sides every week.
The same time. Yeah, you can't do it. So that would have happened anyway. It's not like he was so into it and they had to like push him away. It was like that happens eventually.
Yeah, you need to waxes and wanes.
Right. So what would have happened maybe if he wanted to was he would have gone to another. He could have gone to AWA, which is huge in Minnesota, and did like a whole thing.
Which are these things that we've talked about on the show before? There was all small regional wrestling.
Yeah, the territories it was called.
WWF and WCW bought up and then eventually became one company. Right?
Well, yeah, it was weird. It was like the mob. It was like they just like. It was a cabal. Like, all these guys got together and were, like, divvied up the country. Yeah. And we're like, you have this, you have this, you have this.
But that's, I mean, that's what happened. We were talking before we were recording about deregulation.
Right.
But that's what happened in so many industries in the 80s.
Cable.
Like, cable, the soda bottling industry. So you had all these regional soda bottling plants that all had, like, regional sodas, like Kickapoo Joy Juice Cheer Wine. But Coke and Pepsi bought up all these regional ones just because they wanted the bottling plant.
Right.
So they bought Cheer Wine so they could use their equipment. Got rid of their soda, and now it's a Pepsi plant.
Right.
Or even TV Guide started as regional, unrelated magazines that the Philadelphia TV Guide bought all of eventually.
Put them all
under the umbrella. Yeah, based on
Philly. Yeah, this is like, you know, this is like what happens in all industries in capitalism, right? I mean, it becomes a monopoly eventually, but not a total monopoly, but basically a monopoly.
I mean, like, Diamond Comics, they ruined the distribution.
Yeah, ruined all of comics, basically. So, you know, that's... So I thought that I could tell Andy's story from the perspective that he was, like, wanted to be a wrestler.
Right.
Ultimately.
Right.
Like, it was... He you know, he just used his fame to get into pro wrestling.
Right.
You know, that kind of perspective. And, you know, it was great. I mean, I love the way Andy works and stuff. And I think that he's, like, improvises and he just like comes up. He has his character and he just, it's kind of like the way Bobby Heenan, this old WWE, this old manager.
The Brain. Yeah. Just died last year, didn't he?
Yeah, yeah. He had throat surgery, throat problems, and he like lost part of his jaw, so he couldn't talk for a long time before he died, but he was amazing. And like one of the things that made him so great was like his character was like a buffoon, so he's like, I couldn't mess up. If I messed up, the character is an idiot. And I think that's kind of like partially like what Andy's characters were like. It wasn't like he had this whole thing like mapped out in his head how it was gonna go. He just like read the room and kind of like, I mean, and that's how wrestling used to work, like,
yeah,
the way wrestlers had to work.
It's like stand-up comedy.
Yeah, yeah.
And that, you know, those guys, and I look at it the same way, because a lot of those wrestlers who just traveled around and were lonely, sad guys who have to go and perform and read the room and and sort of recreate the magic
every
night.
It's so similar. I always think about those things, comedians and wrestlers on the road when I do these book tours. It's only like 1 week a year, and I'm like,
it's brutal.
It's horrible. Like, yeah. It's really, really bad. I went to France for a week for a French book show called Angoulême.
Did you go to where Andre the Giant's from?
No, that's actually, that's a really, really small, it's really, really small town that's like east of Paris. But so I was in France though for a week and then came home for like 5 days and then I'm back out, and it's like, it's crazy how lonely a hotel room is.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. There's so many comics that I know, like, the only time they've talked to anyone in a day is when they're on stage.
Yeah. I know. You just walk around, you're just like, oh, there's.
Yeah.
There's the region, you know, the local CVS. Yeah. Like, there's.
There it is. I guess I'll go walk down to CVS again. Yes, yeah.
I know.
I hate hotel rooms. Yeah.
It's like you just want to get out of your room. You just want to do anything. But then it's like, what do you do?
Yeah.
There's nothing really to do. You're just like sitting around.
So it makes sense that someone who started as a stand up would find a similar sort of world in wrestling, because it's similar damage in the people as well.
It's true. Yeah.
So you had access basically to his, through the wrestling thing to start.
A little bit, but the funny part, the punchline of that story about Bill Apter is that when I went to start working on the book, he like dodged me the whole time and I couldn't even talk to him. But he did like a live speaking show and wrote a book about his experience.
Right.
And I, at the live show, asked him a few questions about Annie Kaufman. So I kind of,
you get some on the record.
I got
stuff
enough. Yeah. And then, but everybody else was amazingly forthcoming, like about Annie's brother, Michael, and, Bob Zamuda, and a bunch of other wrestling people too, like Jim Cornette. And, you know, I talked to like Freddie Blassie's biographer and like
did my breakfast with Blassie.
Yeah.
Like Johnny Legend.
I didn't talk to Johnny Legend. I couldn't get in touch with him. Or Lynn Margulies. I would have liked to talk
to her. Yeah. I've talked to her before. She's really very nice. Yeah.
Yeah. I would have liked to talk to her. But like also that whole, I just didn't really focus on their relationship as a thing, because I was like,
we've seen that film.
Yeah. And it was just wasn't super relevant to his wrestling career. Yeah, it's funny. That's the funny thing, is that everyone was really like easy to talk to and get in touch with, except Bill Apter.
Right.
Which was
the
like,
one that kicked off the whole thing, the irony of it.
But and Jerry Lawler was like impossible to get in touch with.
He's doing comics now too, isn't he?
Jerry Lawler is an amazing artist.
Yeah.
He's amazing. He's way better drawing than I am, you know, and it's like,
he's taking a lot of blows to the head.
You know, he's amazing. he's an amazing portrait artist, and but, you know, he's also done a bunch of, like, a shoot interview where he talks all frankly about the Andy Kaufman stuff. And he wrote his book about Andy Kaufman. And there's been documentaries.
So they're all talked out.
Yeah, they're like, I think that's basically, he's just like, I told that story before.
Yeah, rent the movie.
Yeah.
So the next one, you'll have to do Cyndi Lauper.
I would love to talk. I mean, honestly, like, I love Cyndi Lauper.
I love Cyndi Lauper too. She's really nice and really interesting.
Dude, She's So Unusual is like my favorite album.
It's such a good record.
It's amazing.
I've been trying to get her on the show forever, and I've talked to her a few times, but not on the show. But her story about, like, she used to be in a cover band, and she used to get hired to do clone records.
Oh, really?
So she was in a band called Blue Angel that was kind of a rockabilly band, but she could mimic all these different voices. So she would do, like, we're like, we need to put out a quickie record that sounds like Donna Summer. So she'd go in the studio and
like
do this like generic sound-alike stuff.
That's so funny.
And she did like hundreds of them.
Wow.
And she does the Pee-wee's Playhouse theme.
Yeah, Pee-wee's Playhouse.
Yeah, she does that like Betty Boop voice.
Yeah.
But yeah, she just has a story that I would love to hear.
Oh my God, yeah. Yeah, you know, there's a lot of amazing stuff came out of Pee-wee's Playhouse, like the artists that worked on it, like Gary Panter designed it. And
this punk Wayne rock White, anarchist.
This guy Wayne White designed all the puppets, and he's amazing too. And
Rob Zombie worked on that show.
Did he?
Yeah, he was a PA.
Get out.
He helped build the helmet, the scooter helmet.
Oh, really? Which that giant sense. Helmet. Yeah. That was season two. Yeah. I know. It's funny. And then you hear all these crazy stories about it, and it's like, and in watching, like, I watch the Christmas special every year.
Yeah.
And we watched it this year, and there's so many adult jokes.
Oh, yeah.
There's so many.
And like, not even coded gay stuff, no, which is great. All kinds of stuff.
Like, there's this one part where Flory, everybody's like, sit by me.
Sit on me.
No, yeah, Flory's like, stand over me.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
He's like, totally wants to look over.
Jerry's like, sit on me. Yeah, I love that stuff. I had Steve Binder on the show who produced that. He also produced Elvis's 68 Comeback special.
Get out of here.
So he produced Pee-wee's Playhouse and Elvis's 68 Comeback, and then a bunch of variety shows in between. Yeah. But it was like, okay, this guy knows what he's doing.
Loved the 68 Comeback special. He was like, watched it when he was in high school.
Yeah.
And he's like, none of his friends gave a shit about Elvis at that point.
It was like Justin Timberlake now,
yeah.
I guess.
Yeah. Or it would be like your parent. Yeah, like your parents' stuff. And he like wanted to watch it. And
it's great. Part of the reason that was, and I apologize to everyone who's heard this before from Steve Binder, if you want to go back and listen to that one. But that was supposed to be a Christmas special. Yeah. And Colonel Tom Parker was like, we're going to do 8 Christmas songs and whatever. And Binder asked Elvis what he wanted to do. And he was like, I don't want to do that. So he was like, Binder told Colonel Tom Parker to go fuck himself.
Wow.
And he's like, you can't. He goes, this is my set. Get out of here. And had him removed. And then he's like, we're going to do what Elvis wants to do, which is why it's such a good special.
Because
he got to like do whatever he wanted.
Right.
Which he never got to do. But sort of the thread here is all this stuff is clearly TV related. Like all the comics that you mentioned were all like television comics. So I'm presuming you were watching a lot of stuff.
Actually, funnily enough, I just had my first kid recently, and my mom, I was talking to my mom, and she's like, you know, my first word was CBS.
And that was the old people channel.
I guess it was like cartoons and stuff. Yeah. You know,
they had the good cartoons. They had the Muppets.
Muppet Babies.
Then there was Dragon's Lair.
Yeah.
Which was
And Dungeons and Dragons was on that channel too. So in the Andy Kaufman book, I was like focused on drawing a bunch of drawing TVs because like the old TVs are really cool to me. And like, because now it's like you draw a TV, it's just a black.
Yeah, it's a box on the thing. Yeah, it's a frame.
Yeah, but the old TVs have like this chunkiness to them. Yeah. And they're like a piece of furniture, really, you know? So I had a lot of fun drawing old TVs and stuff.
Would you just do web research?
I did a lot of Google imaging for old TVs. I mean, I collect Sears catalogs and stuff, so I have a lot of like, I mean, I was drawing, I drew some camcorders and stuff at the time, which were insanely expensive. That's how I was sourcing.
All the technology stuff. Yeah, yeah. So you grew up in Philly proper, or were you in the burbs?
No, I actually grew up in New Jersey.
Oh, New Jersey. Okay.
Yeah. I moved to Philly in 2008.
Okay.
Yeah.
So South Jersey, like near Philly? Or?
No, I was in North Jersey near like
Hamden?
Union County.
Oh, okay.
Near Newark, kind of.
Okay.
But like the suburbs.
When I was in a band in the 90s, we played some really weird place in North Jersey that was like an abandoned amusement park. That was like, it was like, it used to be like a really 50s amusement park, so it was small, and it was all like fairy tale themed, but it had been closed and they made it into like a nightclub.
Really?
It was the weirdest thing.
Was it the land of make-believe?
Maybe. Yeah. I don't remember. This was like 97 probably. Okay. I have pictures there, but Dashboard Confessional opened the show for us.
That's funny.
But it was really, I was like, New Jersey's weird.
Yeah.
It's a lot of strange stuff here. Yeah. Were you going into New York at all, or were you pretty much just staying?
Yeah, no. I mean, growing up, my mom would take us to the city all the time.
Yeah.
It was always like, she would always go, and I was like, I was kind of afraid of New York City
when
I was a kid. I was like, it's so scary. And I was there this morning by Madison Square Garden, and it's like not, It's like the it's a mall.
Oh yeah,
outside mall.
Exactly. Like I always growing up, I was always like, it's exactly like the Warriors or Escape from New York, right. Or Madison Square Garden is the beginning of Highlander.
Yeah,
and it's scary.
Yeah,
and it totally it's like, isn't.
It's the Mall of America.
Yeah,
except for outside. That's all it is.
Even Sesame Street, which was set in Brooklyn,
right.
was like was grimy.
Gritty. It was gritty.
It was scary. Yeah. Like it was like these kids don't have parents.
Yeah.
Everything's kind of dirty.
Around.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It just hit me recently because the guy who plays Big Bird in Oscar the Grouch,
he's still alive.
Carol Spinney's alive.
Still doing
yeah, he lives about two blocks from here.
Get out of here.
And he is from Boston, which is hilarious because it hit me that Oscar the Grouch has a Boston accent.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah, yeah.
He's like, get out of my garbage.
I've been watching it all the time now with my son. I watch it every morning with him.
Yeah. Does he like it?
He loves it. Yeah. It's weird. Like, he just, Elmo and like, and now he's like, he just likes the puppet thing. So like, I got him. Now he likes Fraggle Rock, too.
Nice.
But, like, honestly, Sesame Street is awesome.
It's really good.
It's amazing. Like, I'm into it in the way that I'm into, like, any other TV show. Like, I saw this one. I'm learning about all the characters and stuff. And I really think that if everybody watched an episode of Sesame Street every morning instead of the news, we'd be like... utopia.
Oh, I feel like that about all the Henson stuff. Yeah. Like, I was like, Henson and Mr. Rogers, I'm like, between those two guys and the Twilight Zone, we were all just better people.
Yeah, it's true.
Because Henson stuff especially, even Sesame Street, had that weird hippie kind of like fuck you thing.
Yeah.
Where
it
was, you Fraggle Rock a little bit more.
Yeah.
But where it was like, we could all be in a utopia if you weren't such an asshole.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was like, don't be a dick. Yeah. It was kind of like that weird thing.
It's the Sesame Street stuff is all, I love it when it's about kindness. And it's just like, it's just about, if somebody falls down, like you go and help them out.
How about
like the most basic things about kindness? And you're like, when you really think about it, you're just like, yes.
Oh, yeah. And it seems trite when you're an adult. Like, we all go through that phase, I think, when we're growing up where those kid shows, when you're like, this is stupid, and you kind of make fun of it and stuff.
Yeah.
And then you get older and you go, this is actually brilliant.
Yeah.
And you're like, well up thinking about it. And I think we're probably at that age with Sesame Street. But, like, I remember, obviously, when Mr. Hooper died, which was traumatic.
For every child.
Yes. Yeah. But was also really... great
because they did it. They didn't have. They could have just like, you know,
he's on vacation.
A new Mr. Hooper the next day and not said a word. But they talked about it and it's awesome.
And it I think it made us deal with that stuff in a much more healthy way when we encountered it in our own life. Like I remember, there's one that specifically was it Maria that was deaf.
No,
was not Maria.
She's still on it.
Whoever the deaf lady was, I apologize, I can't remember her name, but there was one where there was like a kid who was like my age and he was deaf and the kids were like afraid of him because I think he had like big cochlear implants or something. And they were like, no, he's just a kid. And it sounds so dumb to say that, but like as a kid, I was like, oh yeah, he's just a kid.
Yeah,
like,
because
kids are scared of that stuff.
Yeah, it's true. They have one now that there's an autistic child on it and she's just, it's kind of, I feel like hard to emulate what it is that's weird about an autistic child, but they kind of do it a little, but it is more about that. It's more about, unfortunately, it's more really more about teaching the other kids not to be afraid of the autistic kid. Like if an autistic kid saw it, they'd just be like, I don't know how they'd react to it, but regular kids seeing it, it's really like, yo, listen, go talk to this kid. They're just a regular kid. They want to play. They like to play.
Because I think it's a natural thing for kids to like anything different. Probably for just like evolutionary reasons.
Just, like,
they're like, oh, that's like a weirdly important thing to teach them.
Yeah.
And Andy Kaufman, too, is obsessed with kids' shows like that.
Yeah, yeah. When he was growing up. Like, it's Uncle Andy's Funhouse.
Yeah.
He did this like, he was so funny, man. Like, he did this pilot for a TV show that's like takes place in his parents' basement.
Yeah.
And it's just like his old thing, but it's kind of like Pee-wee's Playhouse where like, you know, he's the host, but he's also like an adult child that like must get his way all the time.
It was like Get a Life mixed with Pee-wee's Playhouse and Remote Control.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
If I had to.
Because it had like a real studio audience that was in his studio
basement.
That was in his basement. Yeah.
It's that I'm sort of fascinated about, because we're like, I think we're almost the same exact age, but we're sort of the second generation of people that was raised by television.
Yeah.
And the stuff we were getting was made by that first generation of people that grew up on television.
Right.
So they were just starting to take the sort of cliches and the things right. they learned and flip them around.
Yeah.
Like an adult doing a kid show or,
right. yeah,
you know, play with the cliches of sitcoms and that kind of stuff. And so as a byproduct, we kind of got taught the 25 years of TV they grew up with as well.
Right. Yeah.
And absorb that stuff.
For sure.
You know, with Eddie Murphy playing Gumby or something, you know, like you wouldn't know about that.
Reruns. Like,
yeah.
There's so, like, I've seen probably like hundreds of episodes of Gilligan's Island. That show was on. It went off the air like, decades.
And I bet you didn't like it that much either.
But it was just on.
Yeah. You just
only
watch
have
it.
Like four choices. Yeah. Really.
Yeah. There's so much stuff we didn't really like, but we watched a million times.
All those shows. Bewitched. Freaking.
I was a Bewitched guy versus I Dream of Jeannie.
Yeah.
Did you ever see the Gilligan's Island cartoon? Gilligan's Planet?
No, I don't remember Gilligan's Planet at
all.
It
was a Filmation show.
Oh, okay.
And it was like a really lame space show,
right?
With the Gilligan's Island cast. Yeah.
Did that involve the Harlem Globetrotters?
I think they popped up every now and then. Yeah.
Like, because maybe I'm thinking of something. Wasn't there? Maybe there was like a Gilligan's Island movie that had the
It was a made-for-TV movie with the Harlem Globetrotters, and they play robots.
Okay.
Yeah. They have to play robots.
Harlem Globetrotters were in a lot of TV shows back then.
Absolutely. I don't know how they managed that.
That was like their whole like MO is like they played like pro wrestling style basketball sports entertainment,
which never caught on in any other sport.
It was pro wrestling and basketball.
They had their own cartoon too.
They did.
They were superheroes and I mean, they would just license anything in the 70s.
I mean, and they were in Scooby-Doo, I think. And like everything had Harlem Globetrotters.
There's no reason for all kids to know who the Harlem Globetrotters were, but we all did. Like, you're like, yeah, Harlem Globetrotters.
It was probably owned by like some producer,
I bet.
That had likes, was like, put the Harlem Globetrotters in there.
I always forget, I had Paul Dini on, and he used to work at Filmation.
Uh-huh.
And he was saying that they would, Lou Scheimer would go and sell the shows. And there's like, and he doesn't know if the story is apocryphal, but he had like the license to the Brady Kids. He was trying to sell some show about a kid in a band and some space show. And he's like, I sold the show. And they're like, which one? He goes, all of them. He's like, you sold three shows? He goes, no, I sold one show about the Brady Kids in a band who are in space now. Because they would just do like whatever they had, you know, like, try to get three shows, but just throw this in there. Which totally makes sense.
Yeah.
Like, did you ever watch It's Punky Brewster?
The cartoon
version? With her magic friend Glomer.
What
the hell is that?
Where did that come from?
And I'm like, that must have been some show someone pitched and they didn't want to buy it, and then the guy goes, it's also Punky Brewster. And they're like, yeah, okay.
Yeah. No, Gary Coleman had a cartoon show.
He was an angel, right?
Yeah, it was called The Gary Coleman Show, and he was an angel in it as Gary Coleman, but his name was something else. Like, he had a character name. Like, his name was like Bill or something.
Yeah.
But like, it was called The Gary Coleman Show. It wasn't called like The Bill Show.
Because kids wouldn't recognize, because he was in a movie called The Kid with the Broken Halo.
Right.
Which I think it was like sort of based on that, but they're like, you can't do The Kid with the Broken Halo, the animated series. Yeah,
no.
Yeah.
There was this great Gary Coleman, and I've never been able to find it on YouTube. Someone's got to have a tape out there of, it was like an after school special where he played like a pyromaniac.
Yes, I have that.
You have that?
I will get that to you.
Please do. Yeah. I've been looking for it forever to try to rewatch it. He like goes nuts and he like is mad at his parents and he's like setting their whole house on fire. Yeah.
Did you ever know kids that were, everyone knew like one kid that was like a super pyro?
I mean, like, I'm not going to say that I was the pyromaniac.
Oh.
But I definitely got in trouble for setting a fire one time.
I always was like Frankenstein. I was like terrified of fire. Kids would set fires and I was like, because it just was like, no.
No, it's funny. I remember like in school, like in science class, they showed us how like fire works. And they like showed us how to light a tissue on fire. And then like the next day I set a tissue on fire in my basement and set off the fire alarm.
We, you know, flash paper that magicians use, lens paper, which they use to clean microscopes, looks the same, but it's not the same. And in science class in like maybe eighth grade, someone balled up all this lens paper to like a basketball size and told this kid Joe it was flash paper. So this kid lights it and throws it in the air expecting it to just be gone in a second, but it didn't. It was just like this floating fireball.
Oh my God.
Starts smacking it and now it like the ashes are on fire everywhere.
Right, right.
The teacher came running in with the fire blanket and wrapped this kid in it and then threw him into a sink. It was great. God. It was great.
Don't play with fire.
No. So when I first actually was doing the show, you were like, give me something with different strokes immediately, speaking of Gary Coleman. And we landed on one here that's February 23rd to March 1st, 1985. Not Gary Coleman on the cover.
Right.
We have Bruce Springsteen, Prince, and Michael Jackson.
And weird...
which
it's
is
like this weird portrait of all three of them.
Yeah, it's very
it's a strange composition.
It looks like Bill Sienkiewicz.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, it's like super realistic, but a weird composition.
Yeah, two of these guys are no longer with us. There's also an article in here, a defense of Playboy bunnies, written by Gloria Steinem, which is great. And this is really weird. It's Tuesday night, the Grammys, so that's why they're on the cover. Why Prince and Bruce Springsteen may beat Michael Jackson, which I think
that's got to be some sort of. Look at race in America.
Oh, I'm sure. There's also a really fascinating article in here about TV and terrorism, where networks are seeking ways to cover terrorist activities properly without encouraging murderers, which is like a really fascinating, sort of smart, like well thought out article.
It's TV Guide.
Which is pretty fascinating to me. And again, I always say it on the show, but like TV Guide had some really good writing and a lot of technical writing that was pretty interesting. Also, great little article in here on kids pretending to be the Cars.
Yeah. Because there was a show called Kid Video.
There was. Kid Video was with Robbie Rist, who is Cousin Oliver. Yep.
Yeah, I'm friends with him on Facebook.
Yeah, he's the best. But he that show was produced by some Israelis who wanted to put out albums. They wanted to do like a modern version of the Archies.
Oh, okay.
So they did that and wanted to do like an MTV cartoon.
Right.
And so they had a fake band and then
they
got sucked into the flip side with Master Blaster and the copycats who were against them. And a little fairy who had superpowers when she sneezed.
Right. Okay.
I mean, you know, typical stuff. But I love Kid Video and I have the LP.
Really?
That I actually got from Israel. And it's actually pretty good. There's some good songs on it.
Oh, my God. That's so funny.
But yeah, this is Clever Impressionists, some of rock's biggest acts, and the new video for Nolas Thomas's Yo Little Brother. So it's kids under age 10 playing these different. There's Cyndi Lauper, we got Prince, we got, I presume, Billy Idol, David Bowie, and Rick Ocasek.
It's a pretty weak premise for a TV show.
It is. Kids under 10 pretending to be celebrities. So what's the first thing you went with here? Different Strokes?
Different Strokes, yeah.
So this, why Different Strokes? Why is this a favorite?
You know, it's Different Strokes, I don't even remember. Like, it went off the air before I even was aware kind of television, but it was on every day after school for me at like...
3:30 something.
Yeah,
like that.
It would be like cartoons, and then Different Strokes.
Yeah,
and then you get maybe one or two episodes of Different Strokes, and then like, you know, when a show's on every day like that, you really get a chance to see every episode of the show. So it's like
multiple times,
and like Different Strokes, like it always had, like a lot of episodes were about like a serious problem in the United States and.
Like, you know, the gooch,
you know, but it would be like drugs.
Yep.
Nancy Reagan was in an episode.
Can you imagine, just to put that in context with people, the sitting president's wife, the first lady of the United States, is in an episode of a sitcom.
A sitcom that was, and it was, you know, prime 8 o'clock show, but it was like not for anyone older than 10. Like, it was like, it was weird because adults would watch it, but it was a children's show.
They never focused on the adults.
Yeah. It's really weird. Like, they don't have shows like that anymore that really like had to encompass like the whole family.
Yeah. It's true broadcasting. People used to watch everything together.
Right.
So you needed to give something to everybody.
It occurred to me later on in life that like the advice they were spewing out was not necessarily good advice or anything.
It's
just some TV writer. They were like, do a show about drugs, and a TV writer writes something.
Yeah.
Not necessarily based on real life or anything realistic at all.
Like, most of us couldn't hire Mr. T to deal with our school bully.
Yeah, exactly. It's not like they're bringing in a psychologist to try to like give the kid a best practice look at how to deal with these problems.
It wasn't mindfulness.
Like, no, it was not at all. It was just like, whatever. And then, but I took all that stuff to heart. Like, I remember, like, there was an episode where, like, Arnold, like, they were giving Mr. Drummond a stress test.
Oh, for his heart?
Yeah. And then they gave it to Arnold, and Arnold had all this stress. And then I was like, maybe I'm stressed out. Like, and I was, like, freaking out that I was under stress.
Which probably had the opposite effect on you as a chip.
Yeah, I mean, like, it's really weird. Like, I would just take all that stuff to heart, and it's like...
It's funny that's what stuck with you and not, like, the bicycle man or, like, the kidnapping ones. Or,
I know.
Like, the...
That's another thing watching. I rewatched a lot of these recently. I had to get a Star subscription to watch it now.
Yeah.
It's, like, the only way to watch it. But I watched them all, like, over the summer, and... First of all, Kimberly gets sexually assaulted like
10, three times,
a bunch of times, like all the time.
One time hitchhiking,
because
the guy lures her and Arnold into the car. Do you remember what he tells them he has?
What, a video? Is it a video of a rocket?
Space videos.
Yeah. And Arnold's like, "Yeah, rocket,
awesome." Yeah.
And then, like, you know, she tries to get a job, and the guy sexually assaults her.
Yeah.
Like, she goes on a date, and the guy sexually, like, it's just all.
Which I'm like, I'm glad they're addressing that, but the tone is so weird because during it. They'll be making, like, jokes.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But,
oh,
like,
yeah.
Horribly inappropriate jokes.
And it's
jokes.
All kinds of all the bad stuff, all the wrong things. Like, there'll be, like, victim blaming and, like, whatever. Yeah. And it's just, you know, it's not like anybody is writing this that cared or knew anything.
I think they were legitimately trying. Mm. Like, I think it came from a sincere place. They just didn't know what to do. Yeah.
They were sitcom joke writers, you know.
And the guys working on that show had been working on shows for 30 years. Yeah, like, they started in the 60s. And there was also a weird trend in the 80s of orphans, which is every kid's worst nightmare. You know, if you don't like your parents, that, like, your parents will suddenly die. There was, like, 20 shows.
Yeah. Little Orphan Annie was huge in, like, 1983.
I hate that movie so much.
You know what? It's crazy, because the Little Orphan Annie comic strip is... amazing.
Oh, yeah.
It's like essentially like Dick Tracy, but it's, you know, it's like this girl getting into like Indiana Jones, like crazy adventures.
It's almost like Pippi Longstocking kind of thing.
It's amazingly good, but the movie is terrible.
It's garbage. It was that weird trend of 70s Broadway musicals based on comic strips that Little Orphan Annie is the only one they remember, or like Your Good Man Charlie Brown, Brenda K. Starr, Superman had one. It's a bird, it's a plane, it's Superman, which is god awful.
Yeah.
There was a ton
that they just pulled from the funny papers.
Yeah. Let's do a Prince Valiant and Phantom and this other thing. But this episode of Different Strokes is when it had Switch Network, so it actually got canceled by ABC.
Right.
NBC picked it up for the last season.
Yeah.
Arnold's not in it very much.
Yeah, it was mostly focused on Sam.
Sam.
Yeah.
And this is a great one because Sam's dad comes in. Do you remember who played Sam's dad?
Was it a country singer?
It is. It's a guy who actually wrote songs for Elvis.
Or is it Merle Haggard?
Hoyt Axton, the dad from Gremlins.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
but him and his mother wrote a bunch of Elvis songs.
Mm.
And Hoyt Axton also used to do a ton of voiceover at this time for, like, Peaches.
Okay. I remember
the National
Dairy
Association.
Like a heavy set.
Burly guy. Yeah. I mean, he's great.
Yeah.
And he was supposed to be, like, a jerk. He's so charming. Like, you
it's
just
so
like
funny
him.
All these how often this kind of stuff got repeated. Like, in Growing Pains, in the last season, they brought in
Luke Brower.
Yeah, you know, and, like, his dad came, and his dad was
a truck driver, and he's saying, "You don't speed on Superman's cape."
Yeah. And it's, like, the same exact thing.
Yeah.
Like,
oh, yeah, because people don't
know. It's so crazy. They must have had, like, there's so many plots that just get recycled all the time.
Well, there's a really weird thing that I point out on the show all the time. For some reason, TV Guide, and I have no idea why, this is 85, this is the last season of Different Strokes. They've done this since episode one of Different Strokes. They always call Mr. Drummond... just Drummond.
Oh, yeah.
They never call him Mister. They never use his first name, which I don't even know what it was.
Yeah,
Philip, that's right, yeah.
But it's in, you know, I think why? Because that's in the episode descriptions, like, from the show. They always call him Drummond.
It's a movie the network sent that out.
Yeah,
yeah. It's weird.
He's Drummond,
It's not in any other show that does this.
Yeah.
It's very strange.
I know.
There's also the episode of the show called Otherworld that night, which was a really cool show.
I don't remember that.
Otherworld was... sort of like Lost in Space. This family, it was like a serious version of Land of the Lost.
Okay.
So this family gets sucked into a pyramid and then end up going to all these parallel dimensions.
Whoa.
It's like each episode's a different world. So like what's
like
the
Sliders,
weird... It was very much like Sliders.
Yeah.
And this episode, the Sterlings are captives in a drug-numbered society where families have been outlawed. So it was like this weird dystopian sci-fi family show.
That's so weird.
Very strange, and that's what Different Strokes was up against.
Before. Oh, that was what it was up against?
Yeah, it was on at the same time, which is very strange. Gimme a Break. This is a huge episode of Gimme a Break.
What episode?
It's live. So they did it live. They did an East Coast and a West Coast. And it's because all the actors on Different Strokes were from the theater.
Right.
So they did it live, and it was a huge thing.
From Gimme a Break. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mel Carter.
Oh, I love her so much.
Yeah, she was great. I mean, she was the whole show.
She's obviously a crazy person. Like, she would just be, like, her reactions to things would be completely illogical.
Yeah. I used to watch the show with my grandma, and she loved it.
Oh, yeah. She didn't take no shit.
She loved Mel. It was insane.
She was locking people in closets and punching people. Yeah. Like, I remember one that I was watching the other day, because obviously I watch it still. And she went to the bank because they cut off her phone because they said that she didn't pay her phone bill. So she goes down to the office, and she rips the guy's computer off his desk and just smashes it.
Oh my God.
It's like hitting this guy with the phone.
Oh my God.
I'm like, yeah, that's, you can't do that now.
Yeah.
It's fantastic. But this was the live one, and it was a huge event because nothing was live.
Yeah.
Nothing. And they didn't mess up. They did the two episodes. And then later the show Rock. Remember that show? On Fox, it was Charles Dutton.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Rock.
Yeah, they did the same thing. And then it was such a hit, they did every episode live.
That's wild.
Which was
shows used to be all live like that.
Yeah, because they had to.
Yeah, yeah.
But it made sense. I mean, they're a theater people. Yeah. You know, they're just doing
it. It had that feel of it anyway. I think you can get away with cheaper aesthetics if you're doing the show live. Like,
yeah.
Because it just has to feel like a stage.
Like now. A play.
Yeah, yeah.
I also want to point out one of my favorite shows, Double Trouble, is on with the Seagal twins, who are Katie Seagal's sisters. They're twin sisters.
Get out of here.
They were the Doublemint twins. They're both direct TV.
Those are Katie Seagal's sisters?
Yeah.
That's wild.
They direct a lot of TV now. One of them directed a lot of episodes of Parenthood and stuff, but this was a show where they were twins, and this is the first season, which isn't as good. They live with their dad, and he's a widower. Season two, they moved them to New York City, and they live with their aunt, who's a cartoonist, who created this character called Bongo Bear.
Oh my God, that's hilarious.
It was just this crazy weird New York
show.
Yeah,
we always talk about the fictional cartoonists of the day, like Henry Rush is a big one, you know, Moon Cow or whatever.
Oh yeah. Monroe.
That's a weird show.
There was a lot. You ever see The People Next Door?
In that show?
No, it was a show called The People Next Door.
No.
It starred what's the guy from the principal from Ferris Bueller?
Ben Stein. Oh, the other guy.
Yeah, the guy.
The red-haired dude.
Yeah, yeah. He was a cartoonist who was basically Gary Farside.
Oh, Gary Larson.
Gary Larson.
Yeah.
But the premise was that all the weird stuff he drew were real.
Okay.
But only he could see them. And Wes Craven produced it. And it
weird.
Was a sitcom. Like a jokey three-camera, half-hour sitcom.
Strange.
It's real weird.
Man, they did so many weird things back then.
Bob Newhart played a cartoonist on Bob.
Yeah.
Why is that Cartoonists and Architects?
I don't know. A lot of these shows, the parents would be like a doctor or like a lawyer.
So they could be affluent.
Yeah.
Yeah, but cartoonists... I don't really know many people who are cartoonists.
It's so strange, yeah.
I mean, you are one and probably don't know a lot of people who are cartoonists.
I know a lot of cartoonists, but you don't bump into them on the street
no.
and stuff. Like,
yeah.
Very rarely am I like, oh, what do you do? Oh, I'm a cartoonist. Oh, yeah. Me too. Blah, blah, blah.
But they're never like... They're always like, I'm hustling for my next job because I'm self-employed.
Yeah.
They're never like, oh, I have a studio at home.
Yeah,
I think it's, you know what it probably is thinking about it now? It's a way for them to work at home.
Yeah.
So that they can have them at the house.
You know, that's what a cartoonist of that era would have had a job, would have been like that because, I mean, especially Jeffrey Rush because he did a newspaper strip. So,
which is big money at the time.
Yeah, that was big. So you'd be in a lot of rich.
Be raking in that, that Garfield money.
Yeah.
Do you have a least favorite cartoon strip when we were a kid?
Plenty. I mean, I hated like...
I didn't like Robot
a
Man.
A lot of them. There was a lot that I just would just skip offhand. Like, I didn't really like Mama's Family that much.
Oh, God. Mama's Family is my least favorite sitcom of all time.
Prince Valiant
was
awful. It took up so much room, I always thought. But like, you know, Family Circus is terrible, but I loved it.
But he's kind of hypnotic in a weird way.
I just love the characters. I think, you know, the character designs are really good. They're like almost as good as like Nancy or something like that.
They tried forever to bring that to an animated show and it just doesn't work.
Yeah, there's a Christmas special and it's unwatchably boring.
Have you ever seen the Far Side pilot?
No.
They did a Far Side pilot for an animated series as a Halloween special.
Okay.
Called Tales from the Far Side.
Oh my God.
And it's really great and it's really weird and really dark and there's no dialogue in it.
Oh.
And people hated it. And I'm like, if this was 10 years later, it would have been on all the time.
I mean, I think, you know, with the success of the Peanuts special and that was like, throw something every year they could try something new.
Ziggy's Christmas is pretty good. I like that one. There was a Robot Man one. There's a Bloom County one for Wish That Wings That Work.
Yeah.
With Opus. Yeah, they none of them really stuck. It's always funny to how much they try and nothing really sticks. So what is we have Sunday night? We get the classic 7 to 8 o'clock.
Yeah, because Silver Spoons, I saw Punky that Brewster. Because I was like, why is this on at 7 o'clock? I guess it's because they put a movie on or something.
Well, because 60 Minutes was on CBS, and that was at 7 to 8 o'clock.
Right.
So nobody watched, and no adult watched anything but 60 Minutes.
Right.
So what NBC's thought was, we'll put the kids show on opposite 60 Minutes, and that's our only chance to maybe do okay with ratings.
Right, right.
And they did all right with it. It was a good technique.
Silver Spoons was a little, it was a little Pee Wee's Playhouse-ish.
Because he had the arcade. Yeah, there's some wish fulfillment there.
You know, I remember going to a kid's birthday party when I was, around then or whatever, 6, and he had a million video games in his basement. And later on, I was like, I wonder if he owned those or if they just rented them.
For the day?
Yeah.
Were they, actual arcade games?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And it was, 10 of them. In the kid's basement.
Who was this kid?
I don't know. I don't even remember his name or anything.
Just kid that you went to school with?
Yeah. That's crazy. I got invited to his birthday party. I got him Chuck Norris Karate Commandos.
Nice, nice. So he was like, you can play more than just joust.
I remember being no quarters, you know.
Yeah, you're getting the good thing. But to ship all that in for the day must have been.
Yeah, but I don't know. Maybe he just had them.
Maybe his dad worked for a company and borrowed them.
It could have been anything.
I worked for a vending company.
Yeah.
I borrowed them for the day.
Yeah.
This episode of Silver Spoons has a very special guest star. Bruce Jenner.
Oh, wow.
Helps solve the puzzle of Alfonso's poor school performance. The missing piece was that Alfonso has the learning disability, dyslexia.
Whoa, the dyslexia.
Yeah, that was in a bunch of episodes.
Yeah, an early dyslexia. I know Theo from Cosby Show had dyslexia.
But I remember I diagnosed a kid with dyslexia in elementary school because of the movie Summer School.
Oh, really?
Do you remember that movie?
Yeah.
And the girl has dyslexia, and Kirstie Alley's like, this girl has dyslexia.
Yeah, instantly diagnosed.
Yeah, and I remember I was looking at this kid's, because you would grade are the kid's papers, you'd pass them around,
right.
And his handwriting looked like the one in the movie, and I went to the teacher, I was like 7, I was like, this boy has dyslexia. And he did.
Really?
He did, yeah.
Wow.
So summer school, helping me
out.
And Punky Brewster that night is Punky's in big trouble when she breaks a new video camera Henry had forbidden her to touch.
Whoa. Those were expensive back then, man.
Oh, absolutely. And he was a photographer. That was his thing.
Oh, that was his job?
Yeah, he was a photographer, so he was dipping his toe in videography. Make a big investment.
Was that her foster dad?
He became her foster dad, but it was a huge thing where they wouldn't let him adopt her, and she went to Fenster Hall.
Really?
And he got bleeding ulcers because this is a 4-part episode.
Whoa, he was so worried about it?
He was so worried about it, and his business burned down. So they put her in a Fenster Hall home, and there was a guy named Blade in it who was a Fagin type who was courting the kids to do crimes for him.
Oh my God.
And he came in at a knife fight with TK Carter, who played Mike, the guy
who ran the
it was great. I just remember there's a scene where Mike wraps a bandage around his hand and he goes, you could take the money, man, but you can't take TC, who's one of these kids.
Oh.
And then Blade has this switchblade. He goes, I got something here, says I can do both.
Oh my God.
And then they get in this knife fight.
That was a wild show. The drug episode of Punky Rooster, the Just Say No to Drugs episode of
the Chicklets.
It was wild.
Yeah.
When they were like, come on, let's just do drugs. And they pulled out everything.
They had a suitcase full of everything.
Yeah, they had
the D.A.R.E. program.
Yeah. I mean, it was like Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas.
Oh, yeah.
They had a spread. Everything.
These teenage girls are all Hunter S. Thompson.
Yeah. They had everything. Yeah.
I remember they used the word nose candy in that. Little nose candy.
The Different Strokes drug one, too, was weird. Because the kids were too young.
Yeah.
That was the kid dealing drugs was 10.
Yeah, he's selling joints to 7-year-olds.
Yeah.
But that's what our parents, I don't know if your parents did, but that's what they would tell us. They'd be like, people are going to come to you in elementary school.
Yeah.
They're going to give you LSD and tell you it's candy, and then you're hooked.
Yeah.
And now you're on heroin.
I know. Such lies.
I was I don't think that happened.
When your parents, people lie to the kids like that, and then they find out that it's not. That's not the case, and they just think everything was a lie.
Or they must have been lying because it's probably pretty great.
Yeah,
it has the opposite of the intended effect.
Totally.
Just tell me it's probably not that good. Be like, hey, you know your uncle's friend Rolly? If you do this, you'll end up like him.
Yeah,
and you're
exactly.
Like, oh, I don't do
that. Yeah. No.
That's all I needed. So what are we on, Monday night?
Yeah.
You went with TV's bloopers?
TV bloopers. Monday night's a rough night for TV.
See, for me, it wasn't. I was a diehard CBS Monday night guy.
What was on?
We had Newhart. We had Kate and Allie. We had Designing
Kate
Women. Allie,
I missed Kate and Allie. I love
Kate that and Allie. Show. That's the New York I would want to live in.
Yeah, yeah. No, Kate and Allie was a good show.
This TV's bloopers and practical jokes has, oh boy, jokes on O.J. Simpson.
Oh.
Early local TV appearances by Tim Conway, David Letterman, Jane Pauley, and Suzanne Summers. Also celebrity fan mail with Todd Bridges and Spot the Blooper Contest and a Stan Freeberg classic commercial and Japanese TV bloopers.
Whoa.
It's like YouTube,
yeah,
the TV show.
Yeah.
I kind of am curious to see what the joke they played on O.J. Simpson is.
Yeah, well, they helped O.J. get his little celebrity status.
But he was on everything. I mean, he was like the Hertz rental car guy.
He was in Back to the Beach.
Yeah, I love Back to the Beach.
Me too.
If you've ever been to the Malibu Beach?
No.
Oh, God. If you go out to L.A., I don't know if you're hitting that up on your book tour.
No, not this time.
But in Malibu, the pier where the daughter lives,
yeah,
it's right there.
That's there.
And I've been to where her apartment was.
Over the bait shop?
Yeah, yeah. And I was like... I happened to be staying with a friend near there, and I was like, oh my God, it's the pier. It's well worth going.
Yeah.
I'll wrap you up because you can get out of here.
Yeah, I can.
So where we are. Tuesday, Who's the Boss? You hit all the sitcoms.
Yeah. Oh, that's funny. That's my jam. These are all.
Who's the Boss is?
Like all sitcoms. I just love the whole formulaic.
Do you revisit them now?
Oh, yeah, all the time.
What are some of the ones that you revisit
often? I mean, Different Strokes is definitely my favorite. I've gone back to Silver Spoons a handful of times.
But it sounds like you're watching Different Strokes, Silver Spoons more as like a historical document or somewhat ironically.
Yeah, I'm actually kind of thinking of making a book kind of that takes place in that world.
Okay.
And just the idea of like the child star and Family Ties had a lot of really good stuff in it.
That's a great show.
And I like Family Ties is how Family Ties is like the response to Ronald Reagan.
Yeah.
I just love the whole concept of how that Reagan played into all these.
Everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was either, most of it was con.
Yeah.
But it makes sense given that he was an actor.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It was just, it's really weird. It's not too different from what we're going through now, but it's like a much lighter version of it.
A kinder, gentler version.
Yeah.
Although I was thinking this week about when The Day After aired.
Yeah.
And Reagan had to go on TV the next night and make an address the nation.
Yeah.
Because of a TV movie.
Yeah. Which freaked everyone out.
Yeah.
It's scary as hell.
This TV movie freaked everyone out so much. Reagan
had to go. I read the other day that the British
Threads
is better.
Brutal. It's brutal. I mean, it depends on your definition of better.
More insane, I guess.
I'll put it to you this way. There's a scene where a woman has to sell herself to get three rats to eat.
Oh my God. Wow.
And then there's also one they made, an animated thing they made called When the Wind Blows at the same time.
Oh.
It's by the guy who made the snowman.
Yeah.
Have
you
seen it?
I believe I've seen the beginning of it, but that's like more like it's a man and his wife and they're
dying of radiation poisoning.
Okay,
for 2 hours.
Yeah, and they just kind of like are hunkering down
because they believe the government says like we'll come to save you, and
right.
it's very much more British because they survived World War II, so they're used to being like in the air raids.
They'll
come, and they never come, and they just die of radiation poisoning.
Yeah,
that's it.
Yeah,
it's brutal.
It's really weird. Like, I was scared shitless of nuclear war
all the time.
As a child.
Yeah.
I remember watching, like, the Nostradamus movie.
Oh, yes.
Movie.
The Man Who Saw Tomorrow.
Yeah.
With Orson Welles, that one?
Yeah.
Yes.
And as a kid, I'm being like, oh, my God.
Yeah, because it was like, a great Satan will come from the Middle East.
Real.
Oh, yeah.
And you're like, whoa.
Yep.
I, like, could never sleep at night.
That all started with a Japanese company who made the late great Planet Earth. That was the first one they did.
So is that, that was a book, though, Late Great Planet.
Yeah.
Hal Lindsey.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was that big 70s Chariots of the Gods and Search of. There was that whole weird
day
that fit into the nature run amok stuff. And it was pretty odd. What do we get there? Tuesday, Who's the Boss? This one, Tony starts dating Samantha's teacher. Samantha doesn't have a sister. That'd be really weird because it would be his daughter. and then Wednesday, you went with Charles in Charge.
Yeah. Only Charles in Charge, I don't remember it ever being on regular television.
Season one was. It was an NBC show that got canceled, and then it went into first-run syndication 2 years later.
2 years later.
Which is why he's a new family.
Right, and it's so strange watching. Because when I was a kid, you just watch in syndication, you know, and you're like, what? He had like a totally different family.
Powell's, the Pembrokes.
And it was 2 years later, so a lot of stuff changed.
Yeah.
Like that. Yeah.
They sold the house with the Manny.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That was the weirdest thing. And Who's the Boss and Charles in Charge were part of that weird subgenre they called the Manny subgenre.
Right.
Where you had Mr. Belvedere, Who's the Boss, Different Strokes. It was this really weird.
Yeah, yeah.
We just have a guy who lives here and raises our kids.
Type. Yeah.
Yeah. It doesn't make any sense.
It's very strange.
I want to point out there's a fantastic Fall Guy ad in here with a wonderful painted cover that says Parade of Death. Can cults stop a catastrophe in the streets? Thursday night, would you go with Family Ties?
Family Ties.
Cheers and Night Court.
That's like the home run.
You cannot lose with that. Yeah. And I love so Night Court. Night Court's another thing that I thought of New York like.
Yeah. Night Court was like a show that I loved as a kid. I don't know why.
It's great.
How did I relate to it? It's about...
There's no kids.
As a child, I remember thinking it was like the funniest show.
Dan's a lech. Yeah. This is a great one. This is Qwan Lee's appearance before the court prompts Mac to face responsibility in his marriage. So that was a whole weird subplot. He was a Vietnam vet, and he married her because he was friends with her. He saved her family in Vietnam. She was like 20 years younger than him. He married her so she could get citizenship and come over, but then he turned out he loved her. This episode, she's found living in a brothel.
What?
It's real weird.
Insane.
Yeah, it's really weird. When she's pregnant, there's one where I remember where she's making like odd foods.
Yeah.
And she's like, oh, I have cravings. And Mac just goes, giblet pancakes? For some reason that always stuck in my head.
It's funny. It's like they were doing all these shows. They wanted to have them be workplace shows. But it was weird. Like you think about it now, it's like The Office.
Yeah.
But then it was like Taxi was like the high workplace.
High concept workplaces. Yeah.
Night Court. Evening workplace.
It's a living.
Cheers,
restaurants,
too,
bars.
Like a bar, a workplace at night.
Well, the weird thing about Cheers, and I won't get into my whole theory because now you got to go, but especially being from Boston, that has a different dynamic where it's less workplace and it becomes this great regulator. So you have people from all walks of life in there, and the thing they all have in common is they're all alcoholics.
Yeah, yeah.
And so it's fascinating, and that's why I don't like Frasier, because Frasier from Cheers, totally different.
Right.
Because Frasier on Cheers is this upper crust intellectual who's drinking because he's an alcoholic at this bar with a mailman.
Right,
and
right.
You know, it's just everyone's all in this.
When it
bucket.
Was just Frasier, it was just. Yeah. I don't like Frasier really. I mean, I know there's people that are obsessed with it, but I couldn't get into it.
His character in Cheers is so much better.
Yeah.
And, Cheers.
And his wife in Cheers.
Lilith. Bebe Neuwirth. She's fantastic.
Yeah, she's great.
But that weird thing of like all these people are really sad, which you got in Taxi too.
Yeah.
You don't get in Night Court really.
Yeah. They should be more sad at night. Like Dan, like, really should be, like, the most really depressed guy.
Sometimes they would have him be. Although when they put in that weird backstory, his name really wasn't Dan Fielding. Do you remember that?
No.
He was really a hick, and his real name is Reinhold, and he used to play the accordion, and he reinvented himself and changed his name as Dan Fielding.
As a Newark.
Yeah. It's this whole weird thing that comes in later. It's really funny. And final night of the week, Friday night, what'd you go with?
Benson and Webster.
That's a weird block, but a pretty good block.
I mean, I think they were... I mean, this is all race-related back then. They were like, oh, we have two shows about a black family. Put them on at the same time.
Yeah, and again...
It's like Webster was like a complete rip-off of Different Strokes.
Yeah.
Like, they were like, oh, look, there's a kid with this particular condition that makes him look younger. Let's find a kid with...
Which he says he doesn't have anything. I've had him on the show.
Oh, Gary?
Yeah, Gary's... Emmanuel.
Oh, Emmanuel.
He's like, nope, I'm not... Nothing wrong with me.
No, but I don't know. Well, that's...
He's small.
Yeah.
He's really small.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was very Different Strokes. I had heard that they combined two shows. There was a show called Then Came You that was about the parents.
Was that the original theme?
That was the original title of the show. Uh-huh. And that was that because they were a real couple in real life.
George
and Ma'am. Yeah.
Really?
And so they had the show built around them, and then they had signed Emmanuel Lewis to a development deal. And what networks used to do a lot is when shows wouldn't go, they'd put the actors they had under contract on different shows. Or they would combine shows because they still had to pay the person.
Right.
So I had heard that was what happened with Webster.
Yeah.
Although Manny says that's not what happened.
Yeah.
And it was always his show. And that who knows?
You know, that was another one that changed a bunch. Like they moved.
He burned down the building.
Yeah.
As a pyro.
Oh, really?
He was doing a chemistry set and he burned the whole apartment building down.
Is that why they got the...
That's why they had to
cool
go in the house.
House with the...
With
the house was awesome.
With the creepy doll upstairs from the dead daughter.
Yeah.
Remember that? Why is that there?
They had secret passageways in the house.
Yeah. For no reason.
Yeah.
There's a creepy dead daughter. He's like...
Let's make it a haunted house.
Why? Why? Yeah. There's no need for that.
I don't know. I wonder if they were like, we can have him ride the dumbwaiter. And then we're like, what other...
Yeah.
Secret passageway.
A clock.
Can we do?
Like, it's already sad. His parents are dead.
Yeah.
Remember there's one where he has a box of mementos from his dead parents that he calls his men's toes?
Oh my God.
And Ma'am's like, what? Yeah, that show, man.
And like, wasn't Ben Vereen in that?
Ben Vereen.
Was he his uncle?
He played his uncle and played Ben Vereen.
He also played Ben Vereen?
On the show, yeah.
What, but not his uncle. His uncle wasn't Ben Vereen.
No, his uncle was his uncle Jerry, I think his name was. His uncle played his uncle, who was always trying to get custody of him.
Right.
But then there's a couple episodes where Ben Vereen guest stars as Ben Vereen.
So weird.
I'm like, why are you doing
Ben
this?
Ben Vereen had a weird career.
Yeah, Zubily Zoo.
Zubily Zoo, yeah.
He was on SCTV. Like,
really?
Bizarre. Yeah. Ben Vereen. Really funny in this SCTV
so
episode.
Wasn't he like a dancer? Was that his name?
Yeah, he was like a Broadway guy, song and dance guy. Okay. A bit like Gregory Hines, but cooler.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
Despite Wolfen. And Benson was a spinoff of Soap.
Soap, yeah.
Yeah, and that was a
Which
better
I
show.
I didn't even know Soap existed.
They never reran it. Yeah. Comedy Central reran it in the early 90s, and that was the first time it reran.
Yeah, yeah.
They made a big deal out of it. I never really. Benson's a better show.
Yeah. I mean, I remember like being like, I should get into Soap because it seemed interesting the way they would have all these crazy plot lines
and stuff.
It was
too silly for me.
Yeah.
I love Katherine Hellman, who's the boss.
Yeah, yeah.
And just it wasn't... Benson was a better character on Benson.
Yeah.
Because he was just so... He was so miserable.
Plus, it was just like the good... That, I mean, that's the perspective... It would be like having a character that's the perspective of... You know, the butler. I mean, but like in like Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, you know, they had the butler character. But then the family's all white. So it's like this, the black dude has to fucking do all this shit for the white family. And he's like resents
them. Did you ever see The Secret Diary of Desmond Pfeiffer?
No.
Are you aware of it?
No.
Well, this is a great thing to end on. Uh-huh. 1996, the new WB, it was UPN, did a sitcom set in the Civil War about a black butler who's a slave who it's basically Benson set in the Civil War. So Desmond Pfeiffer is this white family's butler slave, and it's a three camera wacky sitcom called The Secret Diary of Desmond Pfeiffer.
Why?
And it is real weird.
Yeah.
It is. I don't know.
It's crazy. All of the stuff from back then is weird. Like I got really into Beverly Hills 90210.
Okay.
So I've rewatched that a lot. And like, they did a million episodes where they tried to like take on an issue.
Yep.
And watching them from like this perspective, you're like, Jesus Christ. First of all, like, why are they all Nazis? Like,
yeah. Remember like, when Jimmy Walters throws Donna down the stairs?
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. And the one with the kid has a gun and he's spinning it and shoots himself.
Around. Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy. And then, but then they do like a girl gets raped and they're all like, well, why'd she have lipstick on?
Yeah.
And they're all like, yeah, you're right.
That's a good point. I hadn't thought of
that. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. It's, but I mean, that's how people were.
I know.
And probably still are. I mean,
yeah.
I mean,
yeah. It's crazy.
Well, what an up note to end on.
Yeah.
but thank you so much for doing this. I could talk sitcoms all day.
Me too. Me too. I wish I had more time.
Well, maybe we'll do another episode at some point. Cool. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
There you go. The finest episode I've recorded in the basement of a Panera Bread while eating a bagel. Box, really great guy. As you may or may not know, if you're a regular listener of the show, in addition to television, I'm a huge lifelong comic book fan as well. So always like having people from that world on the show. I will put links up to all his stuff, too, so you can buy those books. Again, I highly recommend them. They're great reads and about interesting subjects. And I hope that he does another one as he hinted at there about maybe child actors in the 80s. We don't know. I'll see. But I'm excited to see what it is because I always like his work. So if you want to email me, you can do so at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or ken@icanread.com. You can also go to our Facebook page. Just search TV Guidance Counselor. Our Instagram is @TVGuidance and so is our Twitter. It's also @TVGuidance. So feel free to contact me if you so choose. We also have a Patreon. It is patreon.com/TVGuidanceCounselor. You are welcome to contribute something there, but it is totally not necessary. It does help directly to the show, so I very much appreciate it. And we'll see you next time on a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
Flory's like, stand over me!